Hi, I'm Jim Zogby, and welcome to Viewpoint. We're just 2 months away from the Iowa caucuses and the presidential nominating contest of 2016. The field of Republican candidates is now 14. That's smaller than it was before. Joining me with an analysis and prediction of what might happen is Vin Weber, former congressman from Minnesota and Republican Party strategist. He's advised several GOP campaigns and served as co-chair of Mitt Romney's 2012 campaign. I'm going to call you Congressman Weber.
Whatever you want, Jim.
Thanks for joining us. Before we get into the presidential contest, I want to actually look at the terrain as it is, in particular with regard to the issue of Islam. And it's a complicated one because I think any way you look at what is happening in the public mind is somehow tied up with this Islam issue. The president is held to be Muslim. He wasn't born here. There's this sense of foreign, the fear of the Syrian refugees coming, et cetera. But in 2010, there was the NRCC, the National Republican Congressional
Committee. Campaign Committee for the House Republicans.
Right. They started a campaign running against Park 51, an effort to build an Islamic center near Ground Zero. And they used the TV ads in congressional campaigns in, I think, 17 states. And then you had, in 2012, you had some of the presidential candidates saying loyalty oaths from Muslims. And then in 2000, between 12 and the last couple of years, you had, I'm going to put a picture up on the board, of 27 states mm-hmm. that were considering banning foreign law, by which they meant Sharia law. It passed in the red states, and in the blue states it didn't pass, but it was being debated and considered. And then now you have candidates for president saying no Muslim president, Muslims have to be registered, et cetera. And 30 states, let's put this one up, 30 states where the governors have said they oppose any Syrian refugees because they're a danger to the country. What happened to create this mindset that has become almost a frenzy?
It's really unfortunate. Now, let me go back to the first thing you talked about, which is the mosque at Ground Zero. By coincidence, I think, as you know, Secretary of State, former Secretary of State Madeleine Albright and I had conducted within the last year, reissued a report for the Council on Foreign Relations on democracy in the Arab world. We had a number of 30 people that advised us. Among our most valued and trusted advisors was Imam Faisal, the very person who was suggesting the I guess they called it the Ground Zero Mosque. So we tried to defend him as best we could as one of a voice of moderation and responsibility who was trying to do a good thing. But all of these things you've talked about can be attributed to a certain level of demagoguery, Jim. I don't know how else to say it. If you think about it, this is precisely a time when the United States and the Muslim world should be getting closer together because we have common concerns. And instead, we have people in this country that are trying to push us further apart and make it more difficult for us to work together on common concerns. I don't think that it ultimately works politically in this country. In other words, I don't think people are going to get elected because of this. But the sad news is it may have some resonance within a Republican primary.
Yeah.
And I have to point out, a lot of Republican leaders have taken a different attitude, most notably former President George W. Bush, who in the wake of 9/11 was very forthcoming in talking about the need to welcome Islamic Americans and to be in dialogue with them and not do precisely the things you're talking about. That doesn't excuse the other activities, but there are a lot of voices in the Republican Party that don't want us to go down this path. And this campaign that we're in right now is producing some very, very unfortunate and destructive statements.
It's interesting. You talk about it not being a winning strategy. It's not. Of the states where the NRCC used those ads, I think only in one of 17 races the candidate won. The Sharia law passed in states where there's almost no Muslims, but in states where there were, it lost. And I don't think anyone has ever won, including Newt Gingrich, who made a huge issue of this in 2012, got no traction at all for it. So it's not a winning issue, but it's there. The residual effect, as you say, is there and real. and damaging.
And Republicans think that it resonates in their primary or endorsement process. I don't think they think much beyond that. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, in some state places that are just overwhelmingly Republican, the entire contest is within the Republican Party. I still think that they're wrong about the politics of it, but that's what the presumption is, that this is good politics internally in the Republican Party.
Part of me thinks it also has to do with Barack Obama being president and the foreignness, quote unquote, of the president. It was almost a demagogic way of sort of subtly, or maybe not so subtly, taking a jab. How much of it is that, do you think?
I think that it's an extreme manifestation of a serious issue. A lot of people in this country, I think, let's put it this way. A lot of people in this country say, quote, I am a citizen of the world. A lot of other Americans don't like that. They say, no, I'm an American citizen. There's nothing wrong with having that particular tension in our political system. How much nationalism do you want as opposed to how much internationalism do you want? I think of myself as a patriotic American. But to take it down this road of condemning everything that is not centered in America and questioning the president's birthplace and his religion with no basis whatsoever to do mm-hmm. so is really unfortunate. But there is a manifestation of this that people we need to think about. A lot of Americans are not comfortable with the issue of globalization. You know, you think about this term globalization. In the Clinton administration, Bill Clinton and Al Gore used the term positively. They benefited from it because they were the forward-looking people. They understood what the future looked like. They were the prophets of globalization, and they talked about it and used the word. No one uses the word anymore. It's become a negative because people are afraid of the integration of the world economy, the integration of the world's cultures to a certain extent. And that is an understandable fear. I mean, that's not my position, but I do understand that. But to take it again to the demagoguery of questioning the president's religion or birthplace or condemning everybody that's a Muslim or comes from the Middle East, it's just an ugly, ugly side of this, and we've got to be ready to speak out against it and fight against it.
Let me ask you something else. As I look at the trajectory over the last 15 years since 9/11, which obviously took the country, it was a shock to the system, followed by two wars,
right.
Both of which arguably did not succeed, cost us lives and treasure and prestige, and brought home a lot of young men and women with post-traumatic shock. And then Katrina, and the even small government conservatives in your own party, the smallest mm-hmm. governments, mm-hmm. expect in time of crisis that the government works.
Right.
And it didn't.
Right.
And then in 2008 and 2009, the shock. Middle-aged folks woke up, said 20% of my pension's gone.
Or more.
Right. Unemployment doubled. Yeah. 1 in 5 homes under foreclosure. Yeah, I looked at it almost as a kind of a collective post-traumatic shock.
My stepfather, my mother's second husband, my yeah. dad died a long time ago, had just retired and lost 40% of his wealth in the crash.
Yeah.
Now, some of it, of course, came back, but that's a shock yeah. that changes your whole perspective on the world. And following up on all the other things you talked about, one of the things
it makes people ripe almost for demagoguery.
One of the things that I have said for a long time, I've cited a polling statistic, which I'm sure you're familiar with. Pollsters like to ask the question, is the country on the right track or the wrong track?
Mm-hmm.
Today, I think it's like 62% say we're on the wrong track.
Yeah.
But what I've been saying for a long time is we have had more people saying wrong track than right track for 12 years. Think about that. For 12 years, you know, the country has basically been pessimistic about its future, whether it's because of the wars or because of the natural inability to respond to a natural disaster, or because we remember in the 2006 election we had corruption in my party in the Congress, or because of the financial crash. After a while, in this country, which has been such an optimistic country, open country, welcoming country, after a while, pessimism changes the nature of the country unless the political mm-hmm. leadership is ready to push back very hard against it. And I think that's what we're experiencing right now.
You know what the most shocking poll numbers, I think, are? My brother always asks what he calls the Reagan question. Are you better off than you were? And he follows it with, will your children be better off than you are? He calls that the middle class question,
yeah,
because the definition almost of the middle class is we're upwardly mobile.
Right, right.
Before the shock of the economic collapse in 2008, two-thirds always said, even if they said the country's on the wrong track, two-thirds of them say, my kids are going to do better.
Yeah.
It's now flipped, and two-thirds now believe that my children will not be better, and may not even do as well as we're doing. And I think we're seeing that
play out. I'm going to start quoting your brother. I didn't know that.
Saying it play out in our own lives.
Yeah.
I mean, that's that. Given that, I think sometimes, you know, a middle-aged, middle-class white guy waking up, losing all this, and some very bright, young, African-American male gets elected president, and it plays into some deeper anxieties of, you know, the Donald Trump, I'm losing my country, I want my country back. There's almost, like I said, a trauma, a collective trauma here.
There is, but if you think about it, we had a similar, not as extreme, but a similar experience in the late 1970s when we'd had the highest inflation rate since World War II, and we had recession at the same time, so we called it stagflation.
Yeah.
And you think about who
interest rates of 14%.
14%. Short-term borrowing rates for small business people were over 20% for small business. So you think about how the two political leaders who won under these circumstances, one was Ronald Reagan and the other was Barack Obama. They did not win by being fundamentally pessimistic about the country and just going around telling everybody how bad it was. You know, with Reagan, it became morning in America. Mm-hmm. Barack Obama talked about, in expansive terms, about how we were going to solve all these problems. There ought to be a lesson in that for both parties, that you can get only so far playing on people's fears and agitating them. Ultimately, people are not going to elect a pessimistic, negative, punitive government. They're going to elect somebody that offers a positive direction for the future, and the other party may not buy that, as my party doesn't buy the policies of Barack Obama. But if you're looking for electoral success, don't elect a naysayer.
Let me go back to the Muslim question again, because it has had an impact on the electorate. Here's some numbers from a poll that we've conducted. We do it every 2 years. Down here, if you look at rates towards Muslims, Republicans, that's the negative in 2010. This was at the height of the Park 51. Even today, although the numbers have dropped, it's two-thirds, 63% of Republicans view Muslims unfavorably, while 33% Democrats. And it's a demographic issue. Minorities and young people much more positively inclined.
And urban people
who
tend to be Democrats and who tend to live in larger numbers in closer proximity to Muslim populations.
So where's the George W. Bush? I mean, where's the Joe Welch who's going to come and say, Senator McCarthy, have you no shame? Have you no sense of decency? I mean, where does that, would that make a difference? It's not a fringe. It's a major component of the electorate. How do we deal with it?
It's hard. McCarthy was one man who could be put down by other individuals. This is, as you point out, this is a phenomenon in the electorate. We have political leaders that talk sensibly about this. I think Jeb Bush talks sensibly about it. Marco Rubio talks sensibly about it. Governor Kasich from Ohio talks sensibly about it. For the most part, there's differences on small issues.
Yeah.
But by and large, they have been pretty good. I think the new Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, on balance, is the kind of guy that would want to talk about a welcoming party and an open party. But there's a reluctance, because it's not just an individual. There's a reluctance to take on two-thirds of electorate. You probably don't do it with one confrontational speech as they did with Senator McCarthy. It takes a concerted effort by the party to decide where we're going to go and what kind of a party we want to be for the future. You know, if I can take just one more minute on this. One of the things that's going on within the Republican Party, it's represented by the candidates, but it's deeper than the candidates, is a debate about the fundamental strategy of the Republican Party going forward. You might remember after the 2012 election, Reince Priebus, the chairman of the Republican National Committee, commissioned basically a postmortem, which was quite well received, talked about a lot of things, including structure, organization, and technology. But it also talked about the need for the Republican Party to appeal to ethnic minorities, to young voters, to women, where they got beat in the last election. Most of my friends and colleagues believe that inherently. Not everybody. the Trump campaign, for instance, is basically running on a strategy that says we're not going to be able to do that. What we're going to do is increase the turnout and our percentage of the white vote. I think that's a disastrous strategy in a country that is becoming more and more diverse ethnically, religiously, and otherwise. But it's important to understand there are people that believe quite the opposite. I call it the last dance on the Titanic strategy, but some people believe it.
Let's talk about Donald Trump. I want to shift now to the presidential contest and take a look at it if we can. Despite predictions of the pundits early on that it was a flash in the pan and he'd fade, and after each debate, as he'd make flub after another, they say, well, that does him in. You know, you can't call the popular woman host this, and you can't say that about
John McCain.
It's almost he's invincible in that regard. I mean, his constituent base actually wants to hear him say outrageous things. And so in the last poll, let's put that one up, with just a Quinnipiac poll, which I prefer Zogby polls. My brother's a bit better, I think. But nevertheless, it's the one that's getting some traction right now, is 27% for Donald Trump. Marco Rubio 17, and these guys are pretty much tied. Mm-hmm, and I want to take a look at these folks in a minute, but the Donald Trump one, there's a ceiling and a floor. I mean, he doesn't go below this very much, and he doesn't go above it very much. There was that one wacky poll that had him at 43%.
I don't think that makes sense. This is probably true, right?
What do we do with that? I mean, that has to be worrisome to you, because the question is, do they go anywhere else after this primary process is over?
Most of these candidates have been reluctant to take Donald Trump on, and I don't mean personally, but I mean on the issues that we've been talking about and other issues. The only exception is John Kasich. The rest of them have been very reluctant to. And I think that that's a problem that we've got. To go back to what you said about the outrageous things that he says and people seem to like what he says, I think there's a little different way of looking at that. What they don't like is all the people that immediately start attacking him, mainly the media. And that's a strategy that can work with a certain percentage of the electorate in the Republican nominating process. They almost say, well, we don't care what he says. If the New York Times doesn't like it, we think it's a good thing. That's part and parcel of, we talked about this pessimism in the country before. Another related phenomenon, is, as you are well aware, is the decline in respect for virtually all of our institutions. The military maintains some respect, but media, academia, religion, and government all are in decline. So when the spokespeople for the institutional American society says Donald Trump is saying an outrageous thing, the average person, or at least 27% of them, say, I think the country's on the wrong track. I think you're the problem. And so when you criticize him, it makes me like him more.
And in the case of at least the Trump and Carson vote, you have anti-establishment individuals. And Cruz, I think, has to be in that camp, too,
right,
because he's a
so.
Senator, but he runs against the party.
Yeah.
The Republican establishment itself is viewed as the problem.
Yes, that's a difficult
problem. And so the minute Jeb Bush was crowned the favorite of the establishment, it was almost a death warrant.
Yeah. A lot of it, you know, you can't argue in politics with the people. That's not a winning strategy.
Yeah.
But a lot of it is this frustration of the Republican electorate that we've controlled the Congress now through three elections, or at least the House through two and the entire Congress now through a third. And they do not see a reversal of Obama policies. This is what's hugely frustrating to people. Without being condescending, people need kind of a civics lesson. I mean, the President of the United States is still Barack Obama. We still need two-thirds of the votes of both houses of Congress to override anything that he wants to veto. But it's left people enormously frustrated. They elected a Republican House, and then they elected a Republican Senate, and they thought this was going to change everything, Obamacare, energy regulations, taxes, and things like that, and it hasn't been changed. And it can't be changed unless we get a Republican president.
Ben Carson, an interesting phenomenon in that he, I would say like Trump, I mean, the question, I see these articles in the beginning, there were people like China watchers, you know, they were Trump decipherers, like what's he really saying, he really is a moderate because he says this and says that, and it's probably he means this. I frankly don't think words matter to the man. But in the case of Carson, there's also a lack of, they call it policy sophistication. I almost don't think that the issues matter so much. It's the persona that people seem to be attracted to.
I think that there is a similarity, not an identity, but a similarity in how Trump and Carson are answering the questions that you and I would ask about policy. And you know, we want to know, right, what's your tax program and how is it going to work and explain why it doesn't work this way. We want those answers. The voters that are supporting Carson and Trump don't want that answer. What they hear from Trump is, you know that I'm successful. Don't worry about the details. I'll hire the right people to solve the problem. What they hear from Carson is different, but it's in the same vein. He says with a much softer voice, don't worry about what I don't know. You know that I'm a person of character and faith and intellect. You can trust me to solve these problems. So the argument that they're not good on policy isn't making it for their core supporters. It doesn't matter because they're not for them because they think they're policy wonks. They're for them for other reasons, which they keep reinforcing.
I don't mean to be insulting here to the Republican Party, but it is a white party.
Yeah, unfortunately.
It's a very white party, and yet we had, in the last four presidential contests, we had Alan Keyes and Herman Cain, who at one point was leading in the polls in 2012.
And I know Herman Cain.
And now we have Ben Carson.
Right.
Is there something here to look at? Does this mean, is there something that they are saying to Republicans that is being picked up subliminally almost about being the black candidate in the Republican Party?
I think there is certainly something to that. I think you said you didn't want to be insulting to the Republicans. I don't want to be too insulting to the Democrats either, but conservative people like me hear the Democrats all too often trying to racialize their disagreements mm-hmm. with us. A lot of grassroots conservatives in this country are eager to support a minority candidate to prove that their philosophical beliefs drive them and that they're not racists. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Because they so often hear from the other side the race card being played, mm-hmm. if you will. Not everybody, but a lot of them mm-hmm. do. And I think that helps a candidate like Cain last time around or Ben Carson this time, with a lot of people who say, yeah, I'm going to prove that my conservative views are not rooted in race by supporting mm-hmm. an African-American candidate in this case.
Now, Ben Carson obviously plays on the Christian conservative vote, which is a huge bloc in the Republican Party.
Yeah, the largest single bloc in the Republican
and
Party.
And 40%+ of Iowa right. caucus goers. Competing with him in Iowa right now is Cruz, who in the last polls came in number two, or actually 1 point behind Donald Trump. His Senate colleagues don't like him at all. There was an article in Politico the other day about how it's almost the candidate they fear most, more than Trump. Rubio, they're beginning to gather around Rubio as the colleague who they also don't like as much, but they dislike a whole lot less. I mean, Rubio they see as distant and the starstruck boy, and Cruz is the guy who just sort of drives them up a wall by speaking out against the leadership and becoming a real pain on several issues. What's going to happen with the Cruz campaign?
I think Cruz is gaining, and I think he's going to continue to gain. I think he could well win Iowa. He might not, but I think it could well happen. If you talk about the Cruz phenomenon and the dislike of his colleagues in the Senate, I go back to something you said a few minutes ago when you talked about the outsider anti-establishment candidates, and a couple of them, Carson and Trump, are genuinely outside. Mm-hmm. They've never had a day's experience in government. But you, and I would too, put Cruz in that category as well. Well, how did a sitting United States senator and former office holder in Texas become the anti-establishment outsider candidate?
Yeah.
By every day getting up and attacking his own leadership in the Senate.
Yeah.
So he's inherited the opposition of his colleagues, but he's gotten something for it. He's gotten outsider status, and we'll see which is more powerful at the end of the day. I don't know a single senator that backs him.
No, the anti-Cruz is Marco Rubio, in the sense that he is, his record, slight, he's only been in the Senate a few years, but he actually was the the point guy on immigration reform. He actually, when he was not running for president, was looking for ways to kind of work within the structure to pass legislation. Is that going to work against them? I mean, Cruz is saying it will because they want an anti-establishment character, but it appears now that the establishment in the party has moved from Jeb Bush to Marco Rubio as the person they think might pull this out. Tell me a little about Marco Rubio and where you think this is going to go.
First of all, I wouldn't give up on Bush quite yet. I agree that Rubio is gaining. There's no question about that.
We're getting
that.
To Bush next.
I think Rubio is very attractive. I think he tried to do the right thing on immigration. Personally, I moderated a discussion with a group of experts on international development, U.S. strategies to develop third world countries, in which he was the guest speaker. He's very smart.
He's one of the smartest guys on the. Of all the candidates up there, the guy who's mastery of issues.
Yeah, doesn't need notes. So this is a real guy, and he's got a life experience that is real and worth talking about. We'll see if the fact that he's not as anti-establishment as Cruz or Trump or Carson will ultimately hurt him. But I have to believe, there's a lot of Republicans that would actually like to win this election.
Yeah.
And they're looking for a candidate that they can get behind. And I'm as we get closer to the voting, I hope, and it's a hope, not a prediction, I hope that more of my party will be looking at Jeb Bush, Marco Rubio, people like Governor Christie, I think.
Let me get to those right now because we only have a few minutes left, and I'm sorry I ran out of time with some of the other questions, but Jeb Bush, he was viewed as the inevitable and is not now. Matthew Dowd the other day said he didn't think he could possibly overcome the odds against him. Do you think that's true or not?
No, I don't think that's true at all. I do think that he labors under the burden of having been thought to be inevitable. When we started this campaign, all sorts of people said, well, Bush is going to clear the field. Mm-hmm. And we now know that the field is pretty strong and the electorate is churning, and so he's not done anything like that. And the very fact that he hasn't won it early, I think, has hurt him. He is still, in my judgment, the most substantive candidate. Mm-hmm. He still has the best record of executive leadership in government of any of the candidates. He's raising a lot of money. He's going to be raising money in Washington this week. I believe that he's still going to be highly competitive and could well be nominated. But there's no question his supporters thought that this was going to go much easier than it
has. Very different personality styles, but similar experience in government. Chris Christie and John Kasich. Now, they say John Kasich is the Republican Democrats love the most. Mm-hmm. Chris Christie has the reputation of being the shut up and sit down guy. He just got the nomination, the endorsement of the Manchester
New
Hampshire.
And he's gaining in the polls in New Hampshire.
And that's a big endorsement. If Cruz wins in Iowa and Christie wins in New Hampshire, this is a crazy race.
Oh, yeah. That will hurt Donald Trump a lot because a lot of the people that are for
him. It knocks him out of the box, basically.
A lot of people that like him just like him because they think he wins.
Yeah.
And we don't know how he is going to look when he starts losing.
Yeah.
But I also think if it went the direction you're talking about, you're looking for a long, open contest.
Right, right.
And
a last man standing race.
Yeah, you'll see some support for Bush. You'll see some support for Kasich, probably. I don't know if Ben Carson will stay in the race if he doesn't win in Iowa. Iowa has a way of weeding out people. It doesn't necessarily propel people forward, but if you fail to meet expectations in Iowa, it's hard for you to stay in the race. We've already seen that with Governor Walker before we even started voting, but he dropped to 1% in the state where he was expected to win.
To win.
Ended his campaign. Did the same thing to my friend Tim Pawlenty, my governor from Minnesota 4 years ago.
Right.
He lost the straw poll in Iowa, ended his campaign. So Iowa knocks people out of the race, much less evidence that the winner of Iowa gets a boost that gets him to the nomination.
Would you come back after Iowa? And as we go to New Hampshire, I'd like to have another conversation with you.
I would if I get a commitment from you to have coffee sometime so I can tap your knowledge on some of these issues that I don't know so much about.
Well, I want to tap your knowledge on the show. So, well, thank you for joining us. That's all the time we've got for now. For more information, follow us on Twitter at AAIUSA or check out our website at AAIUSA.org. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week on Viewpoint.